One speech in it I chiefly loved. 'Twas Aeneas' tale to Dido, and thereabout of it especially, where he speaks of Priam's slaughter, if it live in your memory. Begin at this line. Let me see. The rugged Pyrrhus, like the Hyrcanian beast, it is not so.
Now it begins with Pyrrhus.
The rugged Pyrrhus, he whose sable arms, black as his purpose, did the night resemble when he lay couched in the ominous horse, hath now this dread and black complexion smeared with heraldry more dismal. Head to foot now is he total gules, horridly tricked with blood of fathers, mothers, daughters, sons, baked and impasted with the parching streets that lend a tyrannous and a damned light to their lord's murder, roasted in wrath and fire, and thus orsized with coagulate gore, with eyes like carbuncles, the hellish Pyrrhus, old grandsire Priam seeks. So proceed you.
Oh, God, my lord, well spoken, with good accent and good discretion.
Anon he finds him, striking too short at Greeks. His antique sword, rebellious to his arm, lies where it falls, repugnant to command. Unequal match, Pyrrhus at Priam drives. In rage, strikes wide, but with the whiff and wind of his fell sword, the unnerved father falls. In senseless Ilium, seeming to feel his blow with flaming top, stoops to his base, and with a hideous crash, takes prisoner Pyrrhus' ear. For lo, his sword, which was declining on the milky head of Reverend Priam, seemed in the air to stick. So, as a painted tyrant, Pyrrhus stood, and like a neutral to his will and matter, did nothing. But as we often see against some storm, a silence in the heavens, the rack stands still, the bold winds speechless, and the orb below as hush as death. Anon, the dreadful thunder doth rend the region. So, after Pyrrhus' pause, aroused vengeance sets him new awork. And never did the Cyclops' hammers fall on Mars, his armor forged for proof eterne. With less remorse than Pyrrhus' bleeding sword now falls on Priam. Out, out, thou strumpet fortune! All you gods in general synod, take away her power! Break all the spokes and fellies from her wheel, and bowl the round knave down the hill of heaven, as low as to the fiends!
This is too long.
It shall to the barbers with your beard!
Prithee say on.
He's for a jig, or a tale of bawdry, or he sleeps.
Say on. Come to Hecuba.
But who, oh, who had seen the Moblet Queen?
Moblet Queen.
That's good. Moblet Queen is good.
Run barefoot up and down, threatening the flames with bison room. A clout upon that head where late the diadem stood. And for a robe, about her lank and all o'er-teamed loins, a blanket in the alarm of fear caught up. Who this had seen, with tongue in venom steeped, against fortune's state would treason have pronounced. But if the gods themselves did see her then, when she saw Pyrrhus make malicious sport, mincing with his sword her husband's limbs, the instant burst of clamor that she made, unless things mortal move them not at all, would have made milch the burning eyes of heaven and passion in the gods.
Look where he's not turned his color and has tears in his eyes. Pretty, no more.